Hello, I'm Hellgast. The launch of a game is a weird time in modern day video games, as most tend to be a mess of bugs unless you download the day one patch. Trying to review a game on launch tends to make the review age like a fine milk. So I wanted to avoid any day one reviews, if I can. However, Multiverse is different since it's in an open beta and it's really close to launch, meaning this is the perfect time to give feedback. All of my problems come from design decisions that were made, as the technical side of the game is really solid. With that said, no more intro, let's get started! Multiverse is Warner Brothers' version of Super Smash Bros., with a big selling point that the game is free-to-play. It sounds like a neat idea, as recently we've seen games get elevated because of free-to-play. Like Warframe, a game with plenty of content that is in this hard-to-follow, clumsy format which leads to accidental grinding and hate. Fortnite, a game that gets a lot of hate because I'm assuming kids like it, but it's a game filled with a shitload of content. From the battle royale to the game creating tools, the only content that's blocked is the skins, which is something we've gotten used to throughout the years. Finally, we have Multiverse's biggest competitor, Brawlhalla, which is a free-to-play Smash game that has a lot of characters and gives the player a good amount of currency to unlock new characters at a decent rate. With all these games, and even a game that has direct competition with Multiverse, how does it handle it? Does it have decent progression, or does it take too long to play and unlock new things? Or is this a free-to-play trap that shows you nice gameplay, then expects you to play hours upon hours to get one new thing? You know, your Apex Legends, where it takes a dumb amount of time to unlock a new character, or you can conveniently skip that grind and buy the character. Unfortunately, Multiverse follows the second method, making it take forever to get a new character unlocked. Under the best conditions, if you play with a friend, it takes an estimated 100 matches if you win. If you play by yourself, it'll take an estimated 200 matches. To be blunt, this is pure shit. It locks you under 5 characters and hopes that you find one that you like, because it's gonna be a while before you can get another. Now all this grinding comes after you complete the beginner challenges, which gives you enough coins to buy a medium-priced character. After that, you have to do a lot of grinding. Or you can do an 8 exercise and buy a new character for the low price of 10 bucks. $10? That's fucking expensive for a fight game. Not even more combat as guest characters have to be iconic movie stars and comic characters. They don't even hit that price. With the game hosting these crazy prices, you think that buying characters is going to be the game's main source of income. Like how other fighting games do it, but it doesn't translate well into a free-to-play model. What makes it worth a traditional fighting game is that you already have a whole roster of characters to play with. Most of the time, the extra characters are just icing on the cake, so they tend to be characters that can make the main roster a guest character. If you're a guest character in your favorite fighting game, it's exciting since there won't be another chance for a chewy road to fly. When new characters in Multiverse don't have this exciting because having them in different and random franchises fight each other, the entire time of the game ends. It doesn't matter how great the gameplay feels if the progression is bad, because when players get fed up, they'll move on to something else. Now I know I mentioned that Apex Legends is a game with bad progression, and it does have a pretty terrible progression across the board. The way they got around it is to give the players the entire bait roster of the characters from day one. The only ones we're missing were two, Optic and Mirage. This gave players options and they could feel comfortable with the character that they would want to play to grind it out. Which is frustrating when you find a character that you like them and you lose them because of free rotation changes, because the game doesn't tell you that you'll lose access to that character until it happens. So you might find someone that you like in the free rotation, save your coins, buy a different character, and then you lose access to your main. But we know that selling characters isn't going to be the dev's main method of making cash. As they state that when Season 1 hits, there'll be more skins for characters. Now I don't want to lie, and I like to be fully transparent when I can be, and after all, I'm a ghost. I hate cosmetics and skins in games, since they do have an effect when developers are creating a game. It's just something that's never talked about. But for Multiverses, I'm fine with them. Now this isn't the case if I want to cherry pick X game. I'm fine with them here, since it's a free-to-play game, and I have to make money somehow. Unlike the $60 to $70 game where they then expect you to pay another 10 to 20 fucking bucks on a single type of skin, it's like, go fuck yourself and lower your price, damn it. While we're on this topic, let's take a quick peek at the other things that you can spend your real-life cash on. You have announcer packs, so you can get the man who said 3, 2, 1, fight with one of the characters in the game. KO style, which is something straight from Brawlhalla, so you can change how your death looks when you're taken out of the ring. Character skins, I don't need to explain these, but at the moment there aren't too many. Then we have profile pictures, which I think they can be bought with gold or premium currency. If I am wrong, feel free to scream at me in the comments. I had to write this section when my internet was off. But finally, we have the current gaming trend, the Battle Pass. safety of your ears, the game has a healthy amount of options for the player to spend money. So why the bloody hell is this grind here? No, I promised myself that I wouldn't be such a negative Nancy talking about this. So instead of me bitching and whining, I'll throw out some suggestions for the day. Which would be an August Christmas miracle as they see this. Now I won't be suggesting the most common option, which is to increase the amount of gold we earn, as the amount might be set in stone, not just by the devs, but by the massive multimedia monster that was born of others. Besides, raising the gold can have effects that can't be seen, but it could make the progression be too fast, which I think is also a bad choice, because progression is weird in games. Some games, that's a great thing, while other games, you'll see Congress having a meeting about violent video games again. So my suggestions will be based around the max gold of the game that the player can earn, which is around 19 to 25-ish. Now the game already has a mission system in place, and the start it will give out gold. After completing those, they turn into missions that give you battle pass points. So I'm suggesting that they either add or replace one of them for a daily mission. This mission will have a simple challenge, like play as a tank, or matches, or something. After completion, they can give you the reward that can range around 50 to 100 gold. These missions can only be done once a day. This will give a nice amount of gold for players, and earning these will make it so the player doesn't have to play 11 solo or 5 2v2 matches. This doesn't fully alleviate the grinding problem, but it does give incentives for the players to hop on daily. These might be more effective than having the daily win rewards, because when the game matches you with amazing players that are significantly higher levels than you, it's not too rewarding to get your ass handed to you. Plus, having the player log in every day increases the chances that they see some cosmetic that they like or think is cool, and increases the chance that they'll actually buy it. The second option is having the player have daily or weekly character trials, where they get X amount of times where they can try out locked characters in PvP or PvE. This method might not increase the user's amount of gold, but instead allows players to try out the characters that they wanted to play, without having to wait for 2 weeks of free rotation to see if they get a character they wanted. Knowing if they like a character in an actual match might give them more incentive to play for longer, to unlock the character, or straight up buy them with a premium currency. But this is mainly to fight against buyer's remorse so that a player doesn't take 10 years to buy someone, just to find out they don't like them, because after that, they'll just feel like they wasted their time, or worse, their money. And let me tell you, playing video games is already a waste of time, and that doesn't stop me. Now the last thing I'm going to suggest, I feel like it's more of a quality of life feature. During my time playing, it took me a while to find the lab. It's your basic training room that gives you the ability to try out any characters of any skins, but it feels sort of varied, as most of the time you'll be looking at the roster of characters as you go from match to match. You either move the lab button somewhere in the character select for players to see it and use it more often, or when clicking a character they don't have, there's a third button that says, to the labs or something. When clicking it, it'll take the player to the lab with a character that they wanted preloaded. Either of these options will help players see that there is, you know, this whole lab feature so that they can try out characters. Plus, it makes the player decision of buying a character much faster versus having to go back to the main menu to find the lab every single time. Now, these are my only ideas. Well, to be frank, I think these are the simplest methods that they could use. Now, since we don't know what the devs have planned, I'm eager to see what their solutions to these problems are. Well, unless they don't see this as a problem, then damn, another game that's a time thief. That's one of the game's biggest problems, but there is more to talk about, so let's walk on down to the game mode alley. With Multiverse being heavily inspired by Smash, I'm really disappointed with the game modes on display here. At the time of recording, the game has 1v1s, 2v2s, and finally went out east with a 4-player free-for-all. Now you might look at this and say, what the hell's wrong with this guy? It has all the basic Smash modes. Now you'd be right, but let's get into the restrictions that these modes have, starting with the game's most prized mode, the 2v2 mode. A game mode that's alright in my opinion, but for me, you can never beat out the 4-player free-for-all chaos. Well, you can, and Smash and Brawlhalla have, with their 8-player Smash game mode that's fun as shit. But once you invite a friend, that's it. All you can do is play the 2v2 mode. So if you want to fight with randoms in a free-for-all, you have to play it solo. So if you have multiple people that want to play the game, that's too fucking bad. But wait, the game has private game mode. It sounds like a blessing because you can have 4 friends playing free-for-all. Except in private games, you don't earn any currency from them. And to top it all off, you can only play the characters you've unlocked. Why? What's the fucking point in a private game if you're stuck fighting with friends who only use their names because you're stuck with them? Trust me, I used to play Smash with a group of friends that took the game way too seriously. You can only fight Fox and Captain Falcon so many times before you decide to entertain yourself with a different system. everyone else geeks out at their Fox moves. When playing video games with Casual Man 9000 trademark pending, I prefer fun over the competitiveness of Shaggy's sandwich throw. It bothers me since the solution's right in your face. Either let me earn currency in private games, and I can't use the whole roster, or I can use the whole roster and can't earn currency. Now before I hear the all-time classic argument from my former nemesis, Drawman Sr., trademark also pending, players are just farming private lobbies to get all the content they want versus us real gamers who played the game and earned all the content the hard way. To that I pray to our Lord and Savior, classic bacon, lettuce, and tomato, that these people don't actually exist, because we all have to face reality. Players that really want the thing that they want will find a way to farm the currency. You can't stop them, it's just an element of gaming, of players wanting to watch the devs gawk in horror as their elaborate systems have been broken from a bored player that just wanted more. Like right now, what's stopping me from queuing up in a 2v2 and killing myself constantly to get the match done faster? Nothing! Because now we have the problem of three friends who want to play something end up playing something else because your private games smell funny. Now, I hate to be that guy, but Multiverse's biggest competitor is running circles around Multiverse. In Brawlhalla, it's a smash like where you earn coins from custom/private matches. It lets you have 8 bots or players in a match for pure chaos on dozens of its maps. It has over 30 heroes, and I could buy skins to play all the characters featured in Multiverse, and then some. Meanwhile, Multiverse has about 5 or 4 maps, and I'm not going to count the one that mitoses itself into its own map every day. Multiverses versus its singular competitor doesn't have much content, plus the content takes ages to unlock. Right now it's getting the press for being the first free-to-play Smash game, which isn't true, as there's been plenty of free-to-play fighting games, and their biggest competitor is a free-to-play Smash fighting game as well. But hey, there's a big company behind it, even though Warner Bros. Doesn't even know what they want to do with games. Remember a few years ago when they were talking about selling their game studio to the right people? There's been plenty of confidence at the studio that has like 2 devs, now 3 under its belt. Meanwhile, Brawlhalla has the backing of fucking Ubisoft. While I may not like a lot of their games, at least Ubisoft most of the time knows what the fuck they're talking about when it comes to gaming. My prediction for this game is that it'll have an amazing, impressive start, but will quickly dwindle under being nothing special. It all comes down to that fucking progression. What's also not helping is all the restrictions for players on how they want to play. If you want a 4-player free-for-all with your buddies, that's insane, so you get nothing from it, and you're still playing the damn game! Its motto should be grind your ass off to get that new character, or perish. While I have been negative to this game, I just want to see changes, as I don't want to see this game die. Because when most games fail, most of the time that means devs lose their jobs or studios are shut down. Especially for a first-time dev, not only that, but competition's good for anyone. But let's stop being negative and talk about something positive. Now it might be odd that I've been complaining about everything surrounding the fighting game, but I haven't even touched on the fighting in general. That's because the most frustrating part about this review, the fighting itself, is great. It's a great mixture of being fast-paced and responsive, and all the characters have these unique movesets that feel like their own character most of the time. It does something that Smash and Brawlhalla have a hard time doing, and that's easy for me to track my own character. It's due to the outlining and giving your character a unique and separate color for your damage that makes it easy to read. I haven't had a moment when things are all chaotic and I just fall to my death because I lost where my character went. My biggest complaint is that the dodging feels a bit too easy to spam. I would love to see dodging use more of the blue bars so it's not just 2 idiots dodging it until one of them gets hit. But maybe I haven't played enough to really get good. The only other thing, and it's the only technical thing I'm going to bring up, is that there was a lot of moments where everyone in the match just kind of teleported randomly. Most of the time this got me killed. I can't tell if it's just lag in the match, or if it's a rollback netcode trying to fix something, and it fucks everyone over. It's jarring and annoying because it's an element out of eye control, so I hope that gets fixed. So the fighting is great, but it's held back with the problems that I've spent the last 90% of this video bitching about. Once Multiverse is a game with a great foundation, held back by the terrible free-to-play progression. If it's not addressed, I can see people moving on to other games. They might go to Multiverse's competitor, which is kind of funny to see. But for now, it's a game I play a few matches before I get the urge to play Brawlhalla or Smash Ultimate due to the variety of characters I can play with immediately. Since we're in a conclusion, I do want to apologize for taking such a long hiatus on video editing. I've recently moved and a whole bunch of projects have springed onto me in the last minute, but I'm back and the next video I'll be tackling is another review of a game that I feel is severely overrated. It also happens to be Elden Ring. So until then, have a fantastic day!
Show 'em what you got, Jack.
Defeat.